of today's presentations. One is the meaning and definition. The second one is the types. The third one is the good features or good characteristics. Yes. Now, this is the definition of the leadership. So I hope now you are prepared for the OT and those who are staying in the Kerala. So because there is a 5 states, they are going to be face the elections. So those are going to face the election, you are it means you are going to select the proper leader of the state. So I am also awaiting. So the Tamil Nadu also is going to be coming 6th election. I am moving tomorrow in the evening, then I am going to be vote, then after I come back. So like this I already planned. So kindly give your voting responsibility in a proper manner, because today, that day only we have the rights to select our own leader. So the leadership, it's much important in the case of the each individual, each citizen. So, and each one has the different leaders. So we may influence by some of the special characteristics of the people. So here the leadership represent a single person or one person may influence his thoughts or attitudes or a behavior of others. So his thoughts and attitudes and behaviors may inspire us. That is why we may treated him as a leader. So this is a definition of the or meaning of the leadership. The one more meaning I'm highlighting here. Leadership is the ability to get other people to do something significant they might not otherwise do. So here, the leadership here, they're highlighting as a ability. So the leadership, nothing, it's not like special. They're not giving us a special references, but instead of that, they're using a special word as a ability. It's an ability. The ability is nothing but the characteristics, some of the special characteristics or ability that people have. So due to that only they're inspiring us. And that ability to get other people to do something significant that they might not otherwise do. So one more definition also I've given. So that leadership, it's energized people towards a goal. So generally, each leader having the goals. Even see the Kerala, nearly 3 or 4 parties, they are going to be face the elections. Each leaders having the thoughts that they have to be won. So that winning, it should be what is helpful for them to be find the CM. So therefore, each parties are working for to reach their goals. And the other definitions of the leadership, anyone who acts as a model. Anyone who acts as a model. So even if you look onto the single party, there is more than 10 or 15 leaders are there, well aware leader. So that people, even the each party may identify with 5 or 6 parties leaders. But why we are selecting as a party leader or in any leader in the sense? Because they act as a role model for the entire group. So that's why they use that definition spread by the given by this thought. Anyone who acts as a model to others in a group is often called a leader of the group. So those are the people who may act as a model. But in colloquially in Tamil, we may use the term Madri and Orumadri. There is a difference between Madri and Orumadri. I hope those are Malayali background, you can understand some words in Tamil. So Madri means it's a role model. Orumadri means that people are having some kind of, what is that? It's not stable persons, okay, they have some kind of mental disability that people is called as a Orumadri. So most of the time the people like to model of the people, but sometimes they move to see a Orumadri. That is issue to the people. So we should be unique. We should be unique. That then only you can be identified as a leader of this the particular group. The other definitions also talking about the leadership. Leadership is a behavior. So the previously one of the authors highlighted that leadership is the ability. But other man is Lepera and Farnsworth. They given the definition as the leadership is a behavior. So the ability and behavior look like a state that affects the behavior of other people. Because the one leader's behavior, it may affect the behavior of the other people. More than that, their behavior affects that of the leader. So that is the definitions. That's why I'm using it as a chair. Because every leaders, they thought to reach a particular destination. That destination is nothing but the chairs. So which the chairs, some people are fighting for the CM post and CM chair. Some people are fighting for the, or constant, standing for the MLA seats. So everything, the designations made by the chairs, that's why I'm using as a chair as an image here. And The other definitions is also much focusing on the leadership. Leadership is the quality of the behavior of individual whereby they guide people or their activities in organizing effort. This is said by the Bernard. So a lot of people are given, even in Google, you may find out the lot of definitions. So kindly explore the definition. So here, my conclusion that about the leaderships, we have the different broad view or the views related to the each leaders, each one having the different caliber. Due to that only we are selecting as a role model or as a leader. But how we are inspiring by there, in the sense, there is a three things important. One is their thoughts, their ideologies, and their behavior, which is showing to us, and their originality, their uniqueness. So these are the main three important layers to influence the each individual. That is why we are selecting the great leaders. And these are the importance of the leadership. Why the leadership is important, even in the education institution like us. See, even our department having the leader, there's a two leaders we have. One is called head of the department, the name of head of the department. Other one is the name of the school, dean of schools. So in our department consists of the department and school consists of two leaders. But in the case of the institutions, we are they're led by the our vice chancellor and registrar and controller. So like this, lot of leaders are there to lead the our institutions. So therefore, damn sure the leadership is need for the every circumstances. The first importance, the effective directions, because without getting the direction, the subordinates cannot be work properly. As an organization come into existence with certain objectives needed, to obtain these objectives, the activities of the organization must be directed. So direction of the activities is affected through the leadership only. Suppose the leadership is not a good person, if he's not able to direct the subordinate, nothing will be possible, nothing to be happened to the institutions. Therefore, the effective leadership directs the activities in an organization towards the attainment of the specified organization goals. That is for first importance of the leadership, that's called effective direction. The second one is called the leadership is a source of motivation. Even why the department, why the university is going very smoothly without having any kind of this, even the people having a lot of disparity, but how it's going to move smoothly in this, because it's also motivation from our department heads or the institution heads. So leadership is the motivating power to group efforts. The effective leadership motivates the subordinates for higher productivity. See, recently our vice chancellor, he invited the entire faculty member to provide a lunch, to offer the lunch. So why he's put like this? That day he speak nearly 10 minutes to encourage the entire faculty member of their group work. Like this, he's giving some kind of motivating word. After that, he's providing the lunch for all the faculty members. So that kind of circumstance make a very closeness to the faculty member as well as with the leaders. So that is for source of motivations. It's needed in the case of the leadership. That is the importance of the leadership. The third one is called confidence. So suppose if you're doing the things by alone, you don't get that much of confidence. Suppose some people be a back of you or front of you, you may get some kind of confidence. That is called leaders. Leaderships create a confidence in the subordinates by giving a proper guidance and advice. So due to that, we are getting some kind of confidence from this we are leading. The next importance of the leadership is high morale. Because if the leader is not good, even the subordinates are also not good. So therefore, the leader, the good leadership increases the morale of the employees, which is in turn contribute the higher productivity. So if all the people are coming properly to the institutions, so they're working as a duty or as an inspiring manner, then damn sure the institution may growth happen. Suppose the institution leader is not worried about whether the teachers are coming to the department properly, even the vice chancellor is not coming to the university regularly. So what it happened, it may influence to the other faculty member also, his behavior. Automatically, the teachers also won't come to the university regularly. Therefore, the leader is a moral example for us. So we have to be, his characteristics may influence to follow these things. Therefore, the good leadership increases the morale of the employees, which in turn contributes to higher productivity also. The next is here, the development of team spirit. Because the leadership, once the leadership is there only, it may go with some kind of synchronous model. Otherwise, each people may treat it as a leader. They can go with their own directions. So a group consists of only one leader, only it's good. Suppose all the 10 members acted as a team leader, nothing will happen. Therefore, there is a proverb is that so many could spoil the food. Okay, so if you want to get the team spirit, we need leaders. Effective leadership promotes a team spirit and teamwork, which is quite essential for the success of any organizations. The next importance of leadership is encouraging initiatives. A progressive or forward or a democratic minded leader always encourages the initiatives on the part of the followers. See, compared to the previous years, our university having a lot of growth has happened in the case of the environmental visibility and cleanliness and all. Because our VC is giving the preference to all the employees as well the workers, and he's accepting all the initiatives and suggestions given by the faculty members. Due to that only, now the visibility of the university comes into the wider way. And the last importance of the leadership, overcoming resistance to change. A leader overcomes resistance if anyone on the part of the followers to organization changes through explaining to them the utility of such changes of both the enterprises and the employees. So some people that always the particular things will never be changed. Like that we have the pre-notions there. So once the leaders give the proper directions, we may eliminate that kind of pre-existing wrong thoughts. So then it may lead to near different aspects. So these are the importance of the leadership. Therefore, every institution or everywhere the leadership is made for an hour to lead the institutional things as well as any organization things. Yes, just I am moving to the next slide. This is the questions may come to your examinations. So be cautious on this. What is the types of leadership in education sector? So even I'm going to highlight the examples related to the education aspects only. So in what way the institution have the different types of leaderships you may pursue from them. So here there is here 6 types of leadership in the education sector. One is called authoritarian, then second one is called paternalistic, like the pattern based, like a parental closeness. The next is called democratic, then the fourth one is called laissez-faire, and fifth one is called transactional, and the last one is called transformation. There is a 6 types of leaderships even we can pursue from each of the leadership statistics into the 6 types. Just I'm going to highlight one by one. Here it's showing the 3 importance of the leaderships. One is called autocratic. So you know, so what is autocratic? It's called authoritarian. So like he acted as a boss. So he is the only person to take a decisions and all. So he won't hear the subordinates' views or the employees' views and all. So his role is only to give the comments on it. Even if he not guide properly, he only give the comments. Suppose the head's telling to do X, immediately he has to do X. So we don't have to be respond. If you give the response also, he won't accept it. He may scold us. So that kind of people is called as the autocratic. So that person may give the comments only as do X. So that is characteristics called as the autocratic characteristics. In the case of democratic, so here there is a 2-way interaction may happen. Even the democratic people, the democratic leader, he's having the 2 idea. So X is an idea or Y is an idea. But instead of telling the subordinate to do X or Y, he may invite the suggestion to the entire subordinates or the entire members that can we do X or Y. Like that, he's giving some kind of spaces to the employers. Once the employers give their ideas, the thoughts, finally he can decide with the team members. Then finally they implement whether it's an X or Y. So here's some kind of democratic understanding between the leaders as well as the subordinates. It means the subordinates may influence for the decision also. So here the democratic leaders provide such a wonderful chance to the entire subordinates. So this is related to the social equity. So generally the social equity possible through the democratic leadership peoples. And the third one, the center one, is called laissez-faire. So what is the problem with the laissez-faire? Here, there is a leader, but he can give the, all the freedom to the subordinates. Even the leader cannot direct anything. So he may tell that, do X or Y as you like. So he won't concentrate what the people are doing. And he's not checking whether they're doing properly or not. So he's giving the 100% freedom to the subordinates. So only the subordinates can do anything as they like. But the problem here, even the subordinates or the employees within the people having the clash, nothing will happen. Even that also is not controlled by the leader, because he's told to hands off only. Like hands off. So there's a task. Why we have to do, instead we can give the task to our subordinates. Like this, he won't concentrate that work whether the people are doing it or not. So that kind of leadership is called laziness. But sometimes it may be good, but sometimes it's not totally fair. Okay. Suppose, see the case, some of the HODs, he may not be available in the department. That's why what he tells, so, okay, I'm not there. You can do what they like. If you have any issues there, you can face it. Like that, they skip and they can do their own work. So only those who are working as the employer subordinate, they may, what is that? Then that some kind of clash may happen between with the subordinates, because the leader is giving 100% freedom to the people. That is why we cannot go with any kind of structural-based implementation. So a lot of issues may arise. So this is called laissez-faire leaderships. So we will discuss one by one. The first one is the authoritarian. So the authoritarian leadership, it's called as in authoritarian or autocratic. The authority leadership style autocratic leader keeps strict close control over followers by keeping close regulations of policies and processes given to the followers. So the definition you're saying. So here the leaders give this very strict or commendable. So he may give the commands to do this one by keeping the close regulation on policies. Then only the head can be able to control the subordinates. So therefore, he's very strict in all the aspects. To keep main emphasis on the distinction of the authority leader and their followers, the type of leaders make sure to only create a distinct professional relationship. Even I'm giving some of the examples. See, in the case of the teachers ordering a student to do his or her assignments, and the supervisor instructions a subordinate to clean a workstation. Even when I give the assignment also, I give it as two different groups. Okay, so even once I give the assign the task, I ask them, do you have any doubts you can ask me? Then only you ask some of the doubts related to that. So here, instead of I am forcing them to do the things, I'm giving the freedom to you. So suppose if you're not giving the freedom, I force them to submit the assignment within a specific day, then I may be autocratic. So that is called authoritarian. So here I won't think about the students. So only the namesake, I want to put the marks of the internal. That's why I force the students to submit your assignment within a stipulated date. So without the consideration of the students' problems and all, that kind of leadership is called as an authoritarian. So the authoritarian tends generally set goal individually. So because the goal set by the individual as a teacher only or as a head, engage primarily in one way and downward communications. So here there is no upward communication, only one direction communication only. Even the teachers may not give the chance for the learners to ask the interact with the teachers. Only the teachers, some teachers you may stress in the schools. So it is very strict. Even the people asking any questions, you may scold them, then immediately and that students also may sit on the bench after this. So that kind of leadership, that kind of teacher may be called as an authoritarian. Their main traits set goals individually, engage primarily in one way and downward communications only, control discussion with followers, and they may give the comments only. Generally, their task is to be given comments. See, there is in terms I put like this, 2 + 2 = 5. Suppose I'm writing the blackboard 2 + 2 = 5. You are telling that, sir, 2 + 2 = 4. Then as a, what is the democratic teacher, I may accept the views. Okay, you are correct, like that I may tell. But if you're an authoritarian, I won't accept my mistakes, what I made myself. So I may always tell the 2 + 2 = 5. For that, I'm giving a lot of proof in this. But we could not be, some leaders, no, they could not accept the other views on the top. What they have in their minds, they think that is only correct. and they only they given the comments only to the subordinate. They won't accept the suggestion given by the subordinate. That people is called as an authoritarian or autocratic. The second one is called democratic. So that you know the democratic way, there's a two-way interaction may happen between the heads as well as the subordinates or the institution leader with subordinates. The democratic leadership styles consist of the leader sharing the decision-making ability with the group members by promoting the interest of the group members and by practicing social equity. So this is making some kind of social equity, social justice also. Here, each subordinates or each employees having the chance to share their views or ideas. So it means some kind of recognitions from the head sides they get it into. That's why there is a close bondage happened between the leader as well as the subordinates or the employees. So generally, this style of leadership encompasses discussion, debates, and sharing of ideas and encouragement of people to feel good about their involvement. The boundaries of the democratic participants tend to be circumscribed by the organizations or the group needs and the instructional values of the people, attitudes like skills, attitude, etc. So suppose when I'm giving the assignment, I'm always asking that even for organizing the class also, I'm asking your conveniency. So yesterday you have the Good Friday. So some devotees of the Christian devotees, they won't come to attend the class. That's why I'm asking the suggestion whether you are ready for the Saturday or a Friday. So based on your convenience of the organization, even the people, some people are giving Saturday and some people are giving say Friday. But when you look onto the report, so most of the people are preferring the Saturday. So even I am accepting both the groups' views. Then finally, I take a decision that so I can go for the Saturday. So that is called X or Y. I'm giving the two preference. So the preference is taken by yourself only. So I'm giving the space for you. Each one, you've given the ideas. Then finally, I'm combining the single idea. So here, each one's the ideas to be recognized by the leader. Okay, that kind of leadership is called as a democratic. Then the third one is called as a laissez-faire. Laissez-faire leadership is equal to the hand wash or hands off leader. But some cases make good. Suppose the head, even some of the example you can class it, even the head not having that much of intellectual, but the subordinate or the employees having good intellectuals compared to the leader. Then immediately the leader gives the task that you can do as you like, because he believes that the subordinates are good. Therefore, they can do in a proper. So in this way, it should be good. Suppose the leader can understand that the subordinates compared to me, they are good. So they give the chance to them to do that work. But sometimes it make a conflict between the leader as well as the other subordinates also because of the laissez-faire nature. See here. Here, the laissez-faire leadership style is where all the rights and power, and it, even for taking decision, is fully given to the worker, to the subordinates only. So, this is a first term, this is a term described by Levin and Lippitt and White in the year 1938, along with autocratic leaderships as a democratic leadership. Actually, leadership, laissez-faire style is something describes hands-off leadership style because the leader delegates the task to their followers while providing little or no direction to the followers. Here, the role of the leader, no, he don't have any role at all. Just to give the task to the subordinates, even he did not give any direction, even he did not watch what it happened, whether the people are doing or not. So just he can assign and he may leave the places and all. So that kind of leadership is called as a laissez-faire. And generally, if the leader withdraws too much, so this is called a withdrawal movement. If the leaders withdraws too much from their followers, it can sometimes result to lack of productivity, focusiness, as well as satisfaction. So laissez-faire leaders allows the followers to have the complete freedom to make decisions concerning the completing of the works. No, so sometimes it may affect the entire group task also. See, sometimes the laissez-faire model is to be good, the leader. So where it may good, where it not be good. For us, I'm listed some of the points here. So where the laissez faire leadership style is good in the sense, the followers are highly skilled or experienced and educated. Suppose my followers, like you are the very intellectual, all the participants are, all the learners are very intellectual, actually well experienced as an educator, then I may assign the task to you without involving much. See, even the afternoon there is a program by the ESNCLC. There we are fixing some kind of group task. Okay, so we are assigning the group only. So we are giving the task to the group members. So we are not much focusing on what they do because we are giving the 100%. We are believing as a leader, the ESNCLC. We are believing damn sure that the entire group member they're doing a proper things only because we believe that the members of the groups. They are very effective, they are very skilled, they are very good to communicate us. So all the caliber they have. That's why we are believing 100%. We are giving the 100% freedom to what they are going to do. So we are giving to them. So that kind of leadership. So even the laser fire is good in the case of the subordinates are very good. Then outside experts such as staff specialists are considered being used. So sometimes we are giving the task to some of the subject experts. So actually we are inviting the subject. Therefore, they can lead properly. So there is no need to be controlled by the head center. And followers are trustworthy and experienced. Then the style is more effective. So when it not be, this style is not be fair in the sense, the followers feel insecure. Sometimes the followers feel insecure at the unable to be the leader. Suppose the leader is there, there is a chance the way of working culture is to be different. If the head is there, the way of working is to be different. If the head is not there, the way of working culture is different. The same thing. If the teachers are watching you, the way of writing the exams should differ. If the teachers not watching you, the way of writing the exam is totally different. So see the circumstance. If the leader is there, we have to keep some kind of dignity. But if the leader is not there, there is no dignity, so we can do what they like. So it may affect the institutional or the cohesiveness of the groups and all. The leader cannot or will not provide a regular feedback to the followers. That is also the biggest problem in the case of laser fire. And the third, the fourth one is called paternalistic. What is the paternalistic leadership? So here, the leader may act as a parent. Even when I was working in one self-finance college nearly 7 years before, I was working in self-finance college at Tiruchendur, one self-finance college. So I'm working as a B.Ed. college. I stayed as hostel. But there is the other colleges near the same institution that is called physical education. I hope you know what is it. Physical education, that is nothing but the B.Ed., M.B.Ed. program. Those who want to be, actors, and those who are going to get the job as a physical director, they can study the course. So that particular institutions, having the leader, so he's the retired person. He came after the retirement to that particular self-finance college. So his way of approach is pretty different. So each month in the evening, each month there is a Saturday and Sunday evening, he may invite the entire colleagues with the family members to own hotels and they sit together and take a dinner. So that nature, it makes a close bond and contact to each faculty member. Even after retirement, he's working more than 10 years there. Now he's become 72. Even he's retired, generally in the retired persons, he may work maximum 5 to 6 years only. But he's working long, even in the according to the NCT norms, in the NCT, even the BBA or MBA has come to the NCT only. There is a norms, more than 65 people won't be work. But the institutions, still they're providing this special salary for him to act as a principal. Because he's making that kind of close bond with the entire faculty members of the institutions. Therefore, there is no problem arise still now that particular college. So each family member, they feel as a family. When they come to the department or when they come to the institutions, they feel as a family because every month he invites the entire faculty member with the family members and sit together and take a dinner. So that day they have a lot of fun, lot of comedy. So, and suppose any faculty having some kind of issues between both of them, he intervening, he may resolve the issues. So he is acted as a parent, the leader. So therefore, automatically the subordinates having some kind of faith and trust it happened to the particular head. So the subordinates also think that he won't make any kind of harmful things to us because he's acted as a father or a mother to him. So that kind of leadership is called paternalistic. Even in the case of when you talk about the Suresh sir, he's having that much of closeness. So when you talk to him, always he can hold, even when he talk to me, he may hold my hands while speaking. So that holding nature, you know, it may feel like, so look like his father. So whenever I'm facing him, I may get more comfortability to speak with him because I have a lot of trust and loyalty along with him. So he's showing me the paternalist leaderships. The paternalist leadership work is by acting as a father figure, by taking care of the subordinates as a parent would. So therefore, automatically the subordinates, what are the directions given by the head? Because they feel that the head or the leader is equal to the parent of them. Therefore, what are the things assigned by the heads, they follow without hesitating, without giving either wrong comments on them. So that is called a paternalistic. The next one is called a transactional leadership. So some of the leader, they are much focused on transaction. See, even our vice chancellor schemes came nearly 1 year before. But immediately what it happened, once he comes here, so because he's from the other state of the Kerala, so he want to get the close contact with the faculty member. That's what he did. So he given the promotion to the people who are waiting for the promotions. So that is called give and take policy. So he may give us some kind of rewards and punishment. From this, he's motivating the people to work together. So that kind of nature is called transaction. So now nearly more than 25, 30 faculty members, we are promoted as the next level of the assistant professor or associate professor. So that promotion, it's called as in rewards. So once he joined here itself, he want to get some closeness to the faculty member. That's why he given this kind of rewards or this kind of promotions. So once you give the promotion, once the heads give the promotion, automatically the subordinates having the soft corner to the heads, or when the heads may assign any work, automatically we may work in 100% involvement, because the transaction leadership focus the leaderships on motivating the followers through the system of rewards or punishments. So it motivating the people to be work in a group manner. The last one is called transformational. So the transformational leader is like a charismatic person. Even we have the different opinion of the different political leader. Even some of the political leaders, suppose I'm against one political leader, I'm against one political party, but I like some of that particular political party leader because of the charismatic personality. So even I am totally against the party, but I like some of the special characteristics of some of the peoples in the party, because that is called transformation. Their charismatic leadership or the intellectual stimulations, it may lead the people's influence the going under his leadership. So suppose I'm working under the leadership of Abdul Kalam is not there, but immediately we may get some kind of transformational one kind of influence may happen, or some kind of inspiration may happen, because we are working with very high intellectual person and very charismatic person. Therefore, what are the things he has saying, we may follow properly, because his leadership or his characteristics, it may influence a lot. So that is called transformation. His behavior or his intellectual stimulation or charismatic leadership may influence to follow his direction. That kind of people is called transformational. Generally, the transformational leaderships, they may treated in a different characteristics. Sometimes they may be charismatic leaderships or individual considerations and intellectual stimulation. Even see, why those who are standing as CSUHA, I don't know, they are standing as a self, no? They are not depends on any party during the election. But there is a chance some SUHA, I don't know what is the terms you are in the Malayalam they are using. SUHA means they are not representing any party, they stand alone. So what is the terms in Malayalam you are using? Please kindly type in the chat box. So that kind of candidate, how we are treating. So even that kind of SUHA candidate having the some kind of charismatic personality or individual consideration. Therefore, even they're not belongs to any parties, they want into the election. They want into the particular constitutional election because of the transformation of that influence and catastrophe is having. So yeah, so what is the name? Swadhendra Sadantari.
Sir, it is Swadhendra Sanarthi.
Oh, Swadhendra Sadantari. What is it? Tadantri.
Stanarthi. Swadendra Stanarthi.
Oh, okay, Swadendra Stanarthi. In Tamil, we use the Swechai. Okay. Yeah, the Asnas is like an independent candidate. Yeah. Sometimes even the independent candidate also can warn the particular constitution. How in the sense, because it's transformational. So we believe that if you come and see MLA, I'm sure it may give us a lot of good things for our constitutions. So we believing then we are putting the vote. So that is called transformational. So even that people's not belongs to any kind of political parties and all. So I hope now you understand the different types of the leaderships. This may comes to the examination. So the first one is called autocratic, then democratic, laissez faire, then parentalistic, then what is the transformation and transactional. So there is six types of that. Just I move to the general qualities of the leaders, but this is general, I'm going to skip it. So you have to focus on this one only. What are the qualities of the good leaderships? That is much important, because that is general. The previous one is general characteristics, like what are the characteristics need for the people's general leaderships, like achievement, adaptable, assertive, competent, comparative, courageous, decisive, energetic, enthusiastic. These are the things is to be need in the case of all the politicians. But in the case of the head institution, like the education leader, they should having this kind of characteristics. One is called self-aware. So what is self-aware? In what way the self-aware may influence the institutional growth? So a good education leader needs to solid understanding of oneself. So he can know what is strength, what is weakness. So it should also have the self-confidence. When a person believes in himself or herself, he or she can do and accomplish many things. Generally, the education leaders with self-confidence are not scared or nervous about the decisions they are making. They are not afraid of what the institution, their fellow teachers or their students in the right directions, and help them to accomplish the goals of the classroom and the institutions. Generally, if I know what is my positive and negative, I can lead the students properly. Even I can go with my co-worker, co-teachers along with them in a proper manner. So that is called self-aware is important. Next is an excellent communicator. The teacher or the leader or head should be, particularly the education sector, should be a very good communicator. The best education leaders are excellent communicators. A leader cannot lead a group of people if he or she doesn't speak with them. The best leaders know how to reach the variety of people in many different ways. See, in the case of the all the political leaders, how they became political leaders, because of the speaking, because of the speaking skills. So if the political leader not having the speaking skills, he is not able to face the elections. So if the people having the good speaking skills only, we may like see this case of the in the Kerala, if you're talking about the speaking skills, particularly in English, immediately we may think about the there is the Congress leader, what is it, Sashidhar, yeah. So immediately the people, even the they have the other opponents, people also, they like to hear his speech because of his that word, the pronunciation and similar styles. They like him. So even some people's not following the parties, but they like his way of communications. So generally, even the education context, the teacher should be a well communicator. For instance, the principal might, that is why the principal or the institution head may have one-on-one chats with the teachers each week. At least the teacher, the principal may talk to the students regularly, as well as the heads, as well as the faculty regularly. That is why regularly our university vice chancellor, he may invite all the teachers to at least 2 months once he is interacting with all the faculty members. Otherwise, the heads may send regular email to the update of the departments and all. That kind of closeness, it may accept by the subordinate as a great leader. So therefore, the leader may act as a good communicator, the resource pool. So even they could not be most of the communicators, no, they should be they are automatically the resource pool, because they having their lot of insight, lot of knowledge. That resource pool only it leads the organization's properly. Suppose I believe that one of the institution head is not at all good. He's not have the broad vision. He's always narrow. He's not having the idea to implement. So automatically, if he's not resourceful, he's not good persons, that institution growth it won't be there. Therefore, the head should be or the institutional leader should be a very resourceful. So the education is a resourceful in open to new ideas. Actually, during the tough economic times, so he may give the proper suggestions. So when you suppose the students are facing any trouble, immediately the heads can give the solution for them. Instead of them to make them to be much trouble, the head some kind of solution for resolving that issue. So that kind of resource pools the teachers or the head should have. The next one is called lead by example. So here the teacher may act as the example. The best leader in the education systems may make it a point to the lead by example and not simply by words. It is easy to spell out rules and dictate them from the ivory tower. More than likely, however, this type of leadership will not have the large impact on institutions. So most of the leaders may act as a leader. Suppose I am become HOD, I should come daily to the department in a proper time. Suppose the university starts 9:30, I should come at 9:30 before. So when the institutions close 5 o'clock, I may go after 5:30 only. Suppose I'm not following properly, I may come 10:30, I may leave the campus at 3 o'clock. Then how it became a leader? So the people may follow my example as a wrong. So they are also growing. So even the heads is not staying the department properly, automatically it may affect the department. No? So therefore, all the heads, all the department, all the institution to act as their example for our example. That is why in the case of when you look onto the our Amritsar, he's staying the campus itself. Therefore, automatically he may comes before the university start. 9 o'clock he may reach there. And even he may work in Saturday, Sunday to our department if he stayed in the quarters. So that kind of dedication is showing. So he's an act as a leader example. So even if you feel to be take a leave also, after realizing that, oh, he's this much of what is the dedication. Therefore, we won't take so long leave and all. So we have the positive notion that we won't take much leave. So we can work along with our head. That kind of good understanding comes when the leader leads as a best example. The last one, the power of teaching and learning. Generally in the institutions, the teacher should be a great learner. So without learning happen, it cannot be teach properly. Therefore, it should be balanced. The teaching and learning should be balanced. We cannot be survive if you are not learned properly in the day-to-day life. So we should be learned by each day. Above all, the education leaders must have the belief of the systems and the students they are teaching. If the leader does not believe them, students can do it, or does not feel to the teachers are adequate, then everyone's doomed to failure. So without the leader, who is also a believer, the institution will likely suffer from the low morale. People will not be motivated to make changes if the leader does not believe the changes can happen. So the leader can believe themselves, and he can update regularly his subjects, and generally every experience in learning. So some leaders know they are not ready to face any kind of difficulties. So you can face the difficulty, then only you may get chance to learn. So these are the characteristics for the good leaderships. So thank you all.